Take it a little bit farther. Don't drop it. Don't drop it. Okay, don't trip. Okay. Whew, perfect. Don't fall. Okay. Oh, I'm tired. Oh, hey there. Have you ever had to carry something super heavy? I just did. I probably should have gotten help from someone, but I didn't. Have you ever needed help from someone doing something? Maybe it was help carrying something really, really heavy, or maybe help squashing a bug that got inside your room. Either way, we're always needing help from others, and that's okay. But sometimes, people aren't around to help us. Or other times, we decide we can do things all by ourselves. This happened once when I was canoeing. If you've never been canoeing before, it's like a really narrow boat. And depending on where you sit in the boat, you have a different job. Now, if you are in the front, you get to decide how fast you're getting places. And if you are in the back of the boat, then you get to decide which way you're going. And if you're in the middle, you just get to nap the whole time, which is pretty nice. Now, I was canoeing with a couple of my campers at a summer camp. And I was so excited. I loved to canoe. I loved to be in the water. I was having a fun time. And both my girls decided to tell me, "Miss Tina, we don't want to be canoeing anymore." But there was a problem with that. We were in the middle of a lake. You can't just decide to stop canoeing when you're in the middle of a lake. You have to get back to dry land. So while both of them decided to both be the person, people napping, I had to canoe the entire boat. So I was going as fast as I could, like, oh yes, I can totally get us back to dry land. And after a while of just trying to get through the lake, I realized we were going absolutely nowhere. We were literally going in circles. Now, this went on for quite a long time, and it took us a ton of time to get back to dry land. Do you think we would have gotten there faster if those girls would have been helping me? Totally would have gotten back faster. But instead, it took us quite a long time just to get back home. Now, all of us need help with different things, and sometimes people can help us. Like, those girls could have helped me get back to land a little bit faster. But there's some situations where people can't help us and we need help that's from someone different. Last week we talked about a very, very important mission that God has given us. The most important mission we will ever be assigned to. Let's read about it in our Bibles. This is in Matthew 28, and it says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." So our mission is to teach others about God and so that they will follow him. And this is no small task. This is a huge assignment we have. It's the most important mission that we will ever have. But God also gave us a few more words following that passage. He said, "And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." He wasn't just gonna say, "Okay, bye now, have fun on your mission." Or he wasn't just gonna take a nap in the middle of the canoe. He was gonna help us with every single step of the way. And he actually gave us a helper. If you know the helper's name, I want you to shout it on three. One, two, three. Great job. If you said the Holy Spirit, you are totally right. God sent us his own Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to be our helper and to go with us through everything that we go through. If you believe in God, you have the Holy Spirit with you to help you complete this mission. Now, Jesus actually talked about the Holy Spirit, and he kind of told us what the Holy Spirit does. Now, in John, we can read, "The Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." That was Jesus talking, and he was saying the Holy Spirit would help us remember what God taught us. So no matter how hard the mission may be at times, we have a helper who goes with us, and God promises this helper will be with us. Does God keep his promises? Yes, he always does. So if you want to know more about the Holy Spirit's role in our mission, I want you to go to our kids page after the lesson today to find out more. Have a great day and see you next week.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face.
morning and happy Mother's Day. We're so glad that you're joining us today, and I just want to give a special welcome to everyone listening in at the Janesville campus, at the State Line campus, and at Faith Christian Church in Evansville. As we worship today, I just want to grab hold of that thought of turning our eyes upon Jesus, looking full in his wonderful, beautiful, glorious face. So often, you know, we get trapped up in the things of this world, the things that surround us, the things that entangle us, the things we chase after, hopes and dreams, careers, money, stability, security. And when we chase after those things, we lose sight of who Jesus is. And we forget about his goodness, and we forget about his love and his mercy. But God calls us, and he gives us that beautiful invitation to come. As we are, come and lay everything at my feet. I got you. I'm holding you. And when we're able to just turn our eyes upon him, something absolutely incredible happens, like that song says. The things of the earth start to grow strangely dim. And we stand in the light of his glory. We stand in the light of his grace and the light of his goodness. There was a young man, a wealthy young man, that came up to Jesus, and he addressed him as good teacher. And before Jesus even answered his question, he corrected him and said, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone." And it's hard for me to stand here and sing about God's goodness, because regardless of what I know, regardless of what I've been told, regardless of what Scripture says, there's still times in my life where I doubt his goodness. And there's plenty of times where I don't necessarily feel like he's a good God. But Scripture promises us over and over and over again that he's good and that he is faithful. He's proven to us throughout history that he's a way maker, that he's a promise keeper, a miracle worker, a light in the darkness. So as we worship today, I firmly believe he is calling us together out of that darkness and into the light. He's calling us to turn our eyes toward him, to fix our eyes upon him, and to worship him for his goodness. And he wants us to see that goodness. He wants us to feel that goodness in our hearts as we stand in his presence. So let's come. Let's come as you are. Let's enter through his gates with thanksgiving. Let's enter through his courts with praise. Let's taste and see that the Lord is good. Let's taste and see that his love endures forever and his faithfulness continues through all generations. turning lives around.
You are here.
You know, I have to tell you that Mother's Day in the church is always a little bit of a struggle for me because we just have such different experiences. Some of our mothers were great and some of them weren't so great. And for some of us, this is just a day of joy. And for some of us, it's honestly a day of pain. In most years, balancing that is really hard. But you know, this year's a little different because no matter what your experience of your mother was or as a mother is, we all share something this year. And what we share this year is this sense of separation that we have. You know, maybe you can't see your mom or you can't see your kids, or even if that's not the case, we're just sort of isolated from each other. And we share that sense of distance. And you know, so maybe this year for Mother's Day, instead of kind of focusing on the relationship, we can focus on the revelation of it. Because through Mother's Day, one of the things that God wants to show us is this incredible love that He has for us. And that song we just sang starts out, "Amazing Grace, love that welcomes me." What an awesome image. What an awesome truth that God welcomes me and welcomes you just as we are. So maybe today when we're separated, maybe when we can't do the things we'd normally do, maybe we need to just pause and be welcomed. So would you pray that with me? God, we are so grateful that we've been able to worship this way this morning. We're grateful for the reminder that today is not just of people in our lives, but of the reality of your love in our lives. The reality that whether we're together or we're apart, your love welcomes us because we are never, ever apart from you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
What's up, church? My name's Logan.
And my name's Haley. We'd love to welcome you to church.
If this is one of your first times joining us at Faith Community Church, we would love to connect with you. On this video, there is a link to a connection card. Now it just takes 30 seconds to fill that out. But if you fill that out, we have a little gift for you.
Now, it's not that big of a deal. It's just the Faith Community Coffee Mug!
We have been doing church online now for almost 2 months, and we would love to do something a little fun together.
So if you're sitting with your family right now, or if you're by yourself with your furry friends, then we would love for you just to grab your phone really quick. Okay, you have your phone? Okay, good. Now what we want you to do is to take a selfie with your family watching church this morning.
Now it doesn't matter whether you're wearing your pajamas or you're wearing your Sunday best, but please be wearing something. But we would love to just engage with you guys and see how everybody is watching church together, and we'll make a really fun collage of it.
So here's a quick example of us and our family. And now again, you can see that we have our furry friends. So get your pets in that picture.
And just have fun with it. And if you would, you can share those in one of two ways. If you have Facebook, we would love for you to share it and to tag Faith Community Church in it. Or you can email it to info@faithjanesville.org. Those are the two ways. We would love to collect those and just have some fun during this time. So, everybody, we just want to say, on behalf of Pastor Jeff and on behalf of the entire staff here at Faith Community Church, happy Mother's Day. And as something a little special in regards to Mother's Day, we have a special song written and sung and performed by Caleb Powers. So get your tissues ready. Here you go.
I wrote this song 8 years ago for my mother on Mother's Day. I hope that it blesses all of you mothers out there as you're celebrating with your family.
You were there when I was born. When I cried, you held me in your arms. I would wonder what to do, but you'd always be there to guide me through. When I was afraid of the night, you would hold me in your arms. You'd hold me in your arms. You say it'll be alright. And I was full asleep, so you're singing quietly. Do you know that you're amazing? You're the one who's always loved me so, and I'm sorry I haven't done more to let you know that I'm amazed by you. You're the defender of the weak, and you always know what bothered me. Can I say that I'm amazed by you? You were there when I was the about how the Lord works and why the world hurts. Let me through every moment. You comfort me when I scraped my knee. I cannot imagine how I'd be if you weren't there guiding me. I grab my guitar and we sing together. Do you know that you're amazing? One who's always loved me so, and I'm sorry I haven't done more to let you know that I'm amazed by you. You're the defender of the weak, and you always know what's bothering me. Can I say that I'm amazed by you? Love you more than I can say in a million lifetimes, in a million songs. And I just pray blessed on this day. Cause my mom's the one who's always loved me so, and I'm sorry I haven't done more to let her know that I'm amazed by her. She's the defender of the weak, and she always knows what's bothering me. Can I say that I'm amazed by her?
Hey, Faith Community Church family, I have a quick announcement for you. It's both really exciting and a little sad, but I am very happy to be able to share it with you all finally. I've been a part of faith community since I was 3 years old. I basically grew up here, and I assumed I would die here. But it seems like God has other plans. This summer, I'm going to be moving to Idaho to be closer to my girlfriend, Carly. She's attending a Christian college there called New St. Andrews. We talked through this for a while and decided that we wanted to get married next year. The first step in that process was me moving out there to where she is going to be. I have a job offer from a good Christian company, and I am really, really excited to be starting this new adventure. Of course, it's also sad because that means I'll be leaving Janesville and all of the wonderful people I've grown up with and lived alongside for so many years. But I couldn't be more happy with what God has been doing in my life, and I hope you'll all celebrate with me as the time gets closer here for me to move out there. Thanks, guys.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to be with you again, and really wonderful to hear from Caleb again. Caleb has been a part of our church, as he said, for so many years, and we're sad to see him go, but we're also happy and excited for his future. Caleb is the most creative person I've ever met. Things that come out of his head are amazing, and it has been a blessing to our church, not only musically, but the medias that he has created for us over the years. And what I've asked him to do, and the reason you haven't seen Caleb, is because I've asked him to take some time and work ahead in Jeremiah and to build a library for us of medias that we'll be able to use for various topics in months and even years to come. So for at least the next month, Caleb is going to be working in his studio, producing media after media after media that we can pull from long after he's gone. And then he'll be back on the music team, and we'll give him a proper send-off this summer before he goes to Idaho. And we also want to thank our State Line team for all the good job they've done in leading us in music. And some of you have been asking, well, where's our team? Well, we're going to be incorporating our team too. So in the next week, 2-3 weeks, you're going to see them coming on board the team and rotating with the team. So you're going to see a lot of faces that are familiar. We don't want their instruments to get rusty either. But we appreciate all their ministry. And as well as I appreciate so much, JD is here, and Mike Powers and Pastor Logan Schwann are here with me. That's all who's here with me recording right now. But I appreciate the team and what everybody has done to minister to you, and I hope you do as well. So we're going to be talking this morning about the best boast, and we are in Jeremiah chapter 9, verses 23 and 24. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and grab that right now and look those verses up with us this morning. Do you ever boast? Do you boast sometimes? I know I do. There's been times I've boasted and bragged. I'm sure you have too. You might brag about your children, maybe put a bumper sticker on your car that talks about the fact that your kids are an honor student, or show everybody pictures of your grandkids, or you wear your team colors with pride and talk about your team's big win and brag on them a little bit. We all do that. Then there's a darker side to boasting as well. There's that darker boasting that the scripture talks about where we're putting the attention on ourselves. And it might be subtle, or it could be overt, but we're communicating the message, I'm a little bit smarter than you, a little bit better than you, a little bit richer than you, a little bit stronger than you, or whatever the case might be. We're boasting in ourselves. And Scripture has something to say about that today. If we turn to Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 23. Actually, before we do that, let's talk about what the word boast means. In the Hebrew, the root word for boast is shine, to shine. We might say, in our vernacular, to put a spotlight on something, to say, draw attention to something or someone or some attribute and say, look at this, look what I can do, or look what they did. And we take pride in it. We shine the light on it. We boast in it. So that's what the Hebrew word means. And what Jeremiah is going to be talking about is when we put that spotlight, for whatever the reason, on ourselves. Verse 23, it says, this is what the Lord says. Let not the wise boast about their wisdom. So that's simply what you know. You might express what you know, like I said, in an overt loop manner and just say, well, I'm smarter than you. Or you could do it in a more subtle way. You could be condescending of somebody. You could ridicule somebody. Let them know through their ridicule that they're not as smart as you are. And we got to be careful with that. When we get into discussions or debates with people either who don't believe in God or who have believe in our God but have different beliefs within our faith about salvation or about some other doctrinal issue, we've got to be careful that we don't come to mock or to ridicule, because that's not how the Word of God says we should handle that. We're to be a servant of the God, so we're to be humble and meek, and we're to be careful with the feelings of those that we're ministering to or sharing with. We don't want to give the impression that we know it all or that we've got all the answers. We want to remain humble. Even the smartest among us has so much to learn. Sometimes we boast in what we can do. And Jeremiah goes on and says, oh, the strong boast in their strength. This has to do with our physical body, what we can accomplish to build, to make, using our strength, using our energy, using our body, our stamina. And so somebody might boast about their strength, what they've been able to do as far as endurance or accomplished through ingenuity, something that you've done, you boast in that. Another way we boast is in riches. Jeremiah addresses that as well, and he says, or the rich boast of their riches. That's what you have. So a person might just come out and boast about their wealth, or they could be more subtle to make sure they know what kind of car you're driving, or what kind of house you live in, or what kind of vacations you take, or how expensive your suits are, or whatever the case might be. People are tempted to boast in what they know, what they can do, and what they have. The people of Jeremiah's day are no different than the people of today, and no different for the people of tomorrow. We do boast. And there's a reason God doesn't want us to boast in ourselves. In fact, I'm going to give you three reasons. First of all, boasting in self magnifies the creature and not the creator. When you boast in yourself, you're putting the spotlight on you. You're trying to say to those around you, I'm all that in a bag of chips, just in case you didn't know. And oftentimes there's underlying insecurities, and that's the reason why we boast. But what we're doing is we are emphasizing the wrong person. The person in the book of James, chapter 1, verse 17, that every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change with shifting shadows. So all the blessings, everything that we have, everything that we know, everything we can do, that all comes from God. He is the source. I'll share an illustration with you right now, and if you like it, great. If you don't like it, you know, Pastor Phil gave me the idea. So imagine you had a dream, and in this dream, you paint a picture, and you paint somebody, and you make them handsome or pretty, and then you decide you're gonna paint in a big house, and you're gonna paint a car, something nice for them to drive, and beautiful landscaping, and somehow in this is a dream, right? In your dream, you can do crazy things. So in this dream, you're able to step into your painting. And so that your painting comes alive. And the person that you painted, and the scenery you painted, and the house, and the car, and everything you painted, comes alive. And in this painting, this person you created looks at you and says, aren't I wonderful? Look how handsome I am, or look how pretty I am. Look what a nice car I drive. Look what a beautiful house I live in. Look how strong I am. I am so much better than anybody else. You'd be tempted to say, look, everything you have and everything you are is from me. I created you. I made you. Then you wake up. It's a dream. But in essence, that's what we do. God created us. He gave us our gifts, our talents, every blessing we have. And then when we boast about what we've done, you know, kind of like Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel chapter 4, look at Babylon the Great that I built by my hands, my great majesty. How'd that go for him? So that's reason number one. Secondly, boasting in self tarnishes your testimony. It's not a good testimony. It's not a good look for a believer who boasts in themselves. In the book of Proverbs, there's two scriptures I want to point out to you. The first is in Proverbs 16, and it says, "Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall." And if you have a haughty spirit, eventually it's going to bring you down. It's going to tarnish your image, your reputation, and in doing so, it damages the name of God. Also in Proverbs 29, it says, "Pride brings a person low, but the lowly in spirit gain honor." If you're going to be prideful and boasting and shine the spotlight on yourself, eventually that spotlight's going to go out, and it's going to tarnish your witness. Is there something that you don't like on your food? Maybe it's a garnishment or a side. Something that maybe other people like, but you don't like it, because when it's on your plate, if it touches anything in your plate, it makes that food taste like the garnishment or the side you don't like. When I was in Sweden years ago, in Sweden, they're really into lingonberries. It's a really tart berry. I hate lingonberries, even though I'm all Swede, all four of my grandparents born in Sweden and my dad. I don't like lingonberries. They taste bad. They're tart. But in Sweden, they put lingonberries on everything, whether you want it or not. I'd be in a line and I'd say, "Please, no lingonberries," and there they are. And so it would, if it touched your potatoes, the potatoes taste like lingonberries. You get the picture. And I had to put up with that all week long. They'd even put it on pizza. It's terrible. So what happens is, when we boast in ourselves, it's kind of like that. Even though there's good things in us, people don't see that anymore. All they see is the boasting, and it leaves a bad taste in their mouth. And the third area that we boast in, or reason we shouldn't boast in ourselves, is because boasting focuses on the temporal and not the eternal. In the book of John, 1 John, the second chapter, in the 16th verse, John says, "For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, does not come from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but everyone or whoever does the will of God lives forever." So all those things we boast in, maybe boast in our wisdom. You know, as you age, you're not as sharp as you used to be. You start to forget things. You're not as strong as you used to be, not as fast as you used to be. You don't have the endurance you used to have. You know, and riches, we've learned from this pandemic that if we didn't know it before, they're fleeting. There are a lot of people who've lost their fortunes, things that they were banking on. The stock market crashed, and maybe their business went under that they've been building their whole lives. And we see how fleeting riches can be. And so God doesn't want us to boast about that which is eternal or temporal. He wants us to boast on He who is eternal. Did you know that God invites you to boast on Him? God invites you to shine the light on who He is and what He's done. The next verse in our text is verse 24. And Jeremiah says, "But let the one who boasts, boast about this, that they have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord." In other words, it's not saying, you know, when it says boast that you know the Lord, it's not about, hey, I know God better than you do. And you get into a debate about who's the holiest, who knows God the most. That's not what it's saying at all. It's saying boast in who God is, boast in what God has done. Put the spotlight on God, who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. In these I delight, declares the Lord. So what we want to do is we want to talk about this. We want to talk about boasting in God. And this is not something that maybe comes naturally, and this is not a discipline that maybe you've done before, but it's something I would like us to work on. So when do we boast in God? How does that happen in the course of the week? How can you boast in God? Well, you boast in God when you pray. You know, prayer is not just a complaint session where you list all the things that are bad and wrong, but prayer really is glorifying God. So when we pray, we can boast about Him. Look at the prayers in the scripture. We'll not take the time to do that today, but you can just look at any of the number of prayers and go to Psalms or go to the book of Acts and see when they pray to God. They boast in who He is. They boast in His attributes. They boast in His divine qualities, the fact that He's immutable. They just boast in God. We boast in God when we sing, when we gather together corporately, and we will do that again someday. In our songs, we're boasting about who God is. You can boast about God when you share your testimony, your story, something that God has done in your life, some blessing that He has brought into your life. When you tell that story, boast in Him. You can boast in God when you're counseling or comforting somebody and you're sharing what God can do for them and what promise God has for them. That's putting the spotlight on God. That's shining on God and boasting who He is. So how do we do that? Well, Jeremiah chapter 24, if we want to bring that back, remember we talked about this a little earlier. He says, I am the Lord who exercises kindness and justice and righteousness on the earth. Right there. So those are His attributes. Next week really is a continuation or a part two of this week. When we get in chapter 10, we're going to talk about God is, and then we'll talk about there His divine attributes. And here we're talking about His qualities, His character, His kindness, His justice, His righteousness. And why do we do that? Why is it important to boast in who God is? It's important to boast in who God is for numerous reasons. One is that it lifts our spirits. It lifts our, you know, a lot of times during this pandemic, we are up and down emotionally, right? Maybe some days we're coasting on, we're doing pretty good. And then it can just, if we're not careful, it can overwhelm us. The sorrow and the death, and we hear too much bad news, too many bad stories, there's too many losses, and it starts to overwhelm us. But when we focus and put the spotlight on who God is and what He has done, it lifts our spirit. It causes us to magnify Him. It causes us to rejoice in Him. It causes us to be humble when we see how great He is compared to who we are. And it really puts our perspective back to where it belongs. Now, what we're going to do right now, we're going to talk about God's kindness and God's righteousness and God's justice. What I want to do is I want to show you a passage of Scripture that I think really captures this truth. Because in this Psalms 103, the psalmist is going to tell us about all those attributes and more. So if you're wondering what to pray, or you're wondering how to boast, pray this. Pray these Scriptures. Right? Share these Scriptures in your testimony. In fact, this is a really good Scripture during this pandemic for you to read through, maybe put parts to memory, and just begin to pray it or sing it or share it, because this does exactly what we've been talking about. In this psalm, it boasts on who God is. And what I'd like for us to do is read it together. So in your Bibles, turn to Psalms 103. Or you can read along with me at home with the screen. But let's read this together and see if it doesn't do the very thing that I've said it would do. Verse 1. Praise the Lord, my soul. All my inmost being, praise His holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all His benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. Say it with me, say it out loud. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known His ways to Moses, His deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will He harbor His anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. Isn't this good? As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Isn't that great? You've just bragged on God. I mean, that just lifts your spirit. We shine the spotlight on who God is. We brag, we boast in our Creator, in our Savior. I want to challenge you to do that this week. Intentionally. Remember, boasting is something you do publicly, where there's two or more. You can't, don't boast but to yourself. Boasting is something you do with somebody. It's something you do verbally. When you're sharing your testimony, or when you're praying for somebody, or when you're having a conversation with somebody, boast in God. Share what you think your God is with someone. Practice that discipline. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you today that we can boast in you. Lord, forgive us the times we become prideful and we boasted in ourselves, what we know, what we can do, and what we have. Everything that we have, everything we know, everything that we can do comes from you. And so you deserve the glory for all things. Help us to do this, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, you remember that we were talking about the YWCA. And one of the unfortunate consequences of this pandemic is that incidents of domestic violence have increased. As people have lost their jobs, as people have become more poor, more frustrated, they get angry, and unfortunately, they take it out on the women and the children. And it's even higher. Even though the numbers have gone up, I'm afraid they're even higher than we think they are, because oftentimes it's in schools that the teachers find the abuse and report it, but not going into school, they're not seeing, they're not getting as many of those cases as they would normally get. It's not a good situation. And Rock County is no different. And so what we decided to do, if you remember at the beginning of April, is we decided to open up a fund for the YWCA, and we had a goal of $10,000 that we wanted to give. And I want to report to you what's come in. Now remember, we're not meeting together. So we're not looking at a chart or a graph each week that shows us where we're at. I've not sent an update out to anybody that tells anybody where we're at. We announced it a month ago and then left it on the website, and you started to give. There's no communication amongst you as to who's given what. No communication at all. And then we wrapped it up after a month. Guess what came in? You ready? Drum roll, everybody at home. Drum roll. $10,087. That's amazing to me. Amazing the number, the fact that it was during a pandemic, and that we could get so close, $87 over our original goal of $10,000. And I know the YWCA appreciates that, and I want to say, way to go, Faith. And let's listen to Dr. Angela Moore as she expresses her thanks to us right now.
Faith Community Church, how can I say thank you? On behalf of YWCA Rock County, I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for your financial support. Thank you so much. Because of your efforts, we can continue our program to serve those who need us most, those children who've been abused, those who are fleeing domestic violence, all of the children in our child care program. Thank you, thank you, thank you. God bless.
Well, everyone, I want to thank you again for being with us today. I want to let you know next week we'll be in Jeremiah chapter 10. Pastor Phil is going to be preaching. I'm going to take one or two weeks off of preaching. I need to work ahead in Jeremiah and plan the next several months of that for our programming team and for those who are going to be teaching and sharing. And I'm also going to be working on our plan for when we come back together. And so I'll be back with you in just a couple of weeks, but I'm going to take a little time away to work ahead and to work on our plan for coming together. And so that's exciting. It's exciting to think about. So as we close out our service, I want to thank you for your support financially, and your support in all the other ways as we want to support you. And so if there's any way you need us, if you need the Faith in Action team, please don't be bashful. Call the church office and let us know how we can serve you. Let's pray. Father, we want to praise you and thank you for the monies that came in for the YWCA. Thank you for the faithfulness and giving of your people. And as we now give our offering today, we pray your blessing upon that. As we continue to minister here in Janesville, as we continue to send support to the nonprofits in our city, as we continue to not only support but increase our giving to world missions, we ask, Father, that you'd multiply these gifts for your glory and for your name. And Lord, help us to learn how and to practice the principle of boasting in our God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless. We'll see you soon.